I'd like to start from directly go into the subject of political Islam. Where is it heading, and what should we expect if we can predict as much as possible? And I'd like to give just a very close example to Israel here, which is the, which I describe as the conspiracy of silence, which is if elections are being held in Gaza today, Hamas, which is an offshoot of the Muslim Brotherhood, would lose the elections. And if elections are held in the West Bank, then the Palestinian Authority would actually lose to Hamas. What does that tell us? This is a very common kind of accepted argument. It tells us that, I remember when Hamas won the elections in Gaza, was interviewed by CNN and said, "What do you think about that?" I said, and my answer was, "There is no Islamic way to collect the garbage, and there is no Islamic way to fix the sewage system. And of course, there's no Christian way or a Jewish way to fix these things. You know, you have to have, you know, proper administration, and you have to do a good job in serving the people." And what I see now, a year after the election of the Muslim Brotherhood's Mohamed Morsi in Egypt, is that the and also following the events in Tunisia, where the Islamists as well won with a majority, is that they are losing a lot of their popularity. The most important thing is that they lost is this sanctity of speaking as if they have an agency from God. In other words, you know, as if they're representatives of God on earth. They've lost that because people, the seculars, have discovered that, you know, we can actually attack them and separate, you know, attack their policies without us being necessarily insulting Islam in the process. So you have now people like Mohamed Morsi in Egypt being attacked by the media openly without that halo of, you know, religion having intervening into the picture. And this means only one thing, that for us to take it for granted that the Muslim Brotherhood or the Islamists are going to take over wherever there is a regime change as a result of a popular uprising, whether you call it the Arab Spring, or whether you call it the Arab Awakening, the fact is that the regimes that have ruled this region for over 80, 90 years, many of which were installed by the colonialists or installed by, and they were secular. The reason why they failed and the Islamists actually won by default is because they were so corrupt and because they mismanaged their economies and because they oppressed the people. And it's very hard, you know, it's easy to close political parties, leftist political parties, as was done throughout the region. It's easy to close the offices of a communist party, let's say, or any, you know, liberal opposition. But you cannot close the mosques. And so religion became a conduit for political expression for a lot of people. And this is how, and also a conduit for organization. So what I'm saying is that it's not just all of a sudden that, you know, people have discovered that, you know, religion is the alternative to the existing oppressive and corrupt regimes. In other words, I think that, you know, the Muslim Brotherhood will not win the next elections in Egypt. At least they will not win it without building a coalition which would alter their entire agenda. And as we've heard from other colleagues, only 20% of people who actually vote for a Muslim Brotherhood candidate votes for that candidate based on their political platform. Only 20% based on the political platform. The 80% who actually vote for the Islamists vote for them because they believe that they are God-fearing people, that probably they are less likely to be corrupt, they are less likely to be oppressive, which of course soon enough they discover that this is not the case. Iran is an example of an Islamic regime that basically now driving the country to hell with its policies, where you have a running inflation of 20 to 30%. It's boycotted by half of the world, if not more. And and creating wars by proxy, killing people in Syria, sending Hezbollah to help, sending arms and funding. And I think that, you know, 3 years ago, people like Hassan Nasrallah of Hezbollah and Ahmadinejad, the president, former president of Iran, were popular figures throughout the region. Today, they are the most hated figures in the region because of what they're doing to Syria, to the Syrian people, and how they're aiding this dictatorship. Ironically, the Iranians cheered when the revolution succeeded in Egypt, but when it, you know, the Arab Spring reached Syria, they had a completely opposite view. And now they're trying to, you know, oppress it with the help of Hezbollah in Lebanon. So what I'm trying to say here is that the transformation is going to be, the transition is going to be very painful. The Islamists do not have solutions to modern day problems. It never did and it never will. Examples of an Islamic regime ruling and producing a successful result does not exist. Wherever a political party, you know, in the name of Islam, whether it's in Sudan or whether it's Pakistan or whether it's Iran, the examples ahead of us don't exist for a good governance by Islamic Sharia. And that's why it's not going to, we're not going to be surprised by them doing any better in the future. What does this mean? The Islam, the political Islam will not play a role in politics. It will play a role in the future, just like it plays a role in Israel, for example, which is a democracy. It's going to be a pluralistic society where the people who insist on using religion as a means of reaching political power will continue to try to do so. But people, in the majority of people, are learning, many probably learn because of the European experience, you know, separation of church from state, secular constitutions that led to civilized societies basically respecting freedom and human rights and multi-party system. Now, in this transition, it's going to be very, very painful, as we see in Syria. I think it's a stain on the face of humanity that this is allowed to continue, this daily massacre of people in Syria. And primary responsibility, of course, falls on the regime, the ruling regime in Syria, and on Iran and on Russia and everybody helping a dictator to stay in power against the will of the people who rose initially peacefully without using weapons. It is the regime's reaction to the peaceful demonstrations that invited the jihadists and the political vacuum that led to the jihadists becoming part of this, you know, sad scenario that we're looking at. My final thesis is that this is not the end of the road. We should not take it for granted that we're stuck with the reality where the Islamists are going to take over everywhere. Egypt and Tunisia are very good examples. Libya is also an example. And if we look at the elections in Iraq since the fall of Saddam Hussein, every next election, the power of Islamic parties is reduced. This is a trend. If you look at the elections, the share of seats in the parliament for Islamist parties reduced in every election. And this means only one thing, that if you do get pluralism and you have free elections, ultimately religious parties will lose ground, and consistently so. And I think that with the growing awareness, thanks to the social media, thanks to globalization, more and more people are getting access. I hear the figure of an increase of 10 to 15% growth in access to the internet in the Arab world every year. And I think that, you know, this globalization in a way is empowering people against regimes that used to brainwash people by controlling all the media, by controlling knowledge. And of course, knowledge is power. Now there is no government that can control the minds of the people. They have to govern properly or lose power. And this is my prediction. But of course, 10 years, 20 years, I don't know, but this is my eventual prediction. Thank you.
Thank you, Salameh.